Joining us now in Hot Copy, we have with us Presidential Anti-Organized Crime Commission spokesperson Winston Casho. Good morning, Winston. Welcome to the program.
Good morning, Katrina, and good morning to all your viewers.
Okay. Winston, let's begin with Alice Go, with former Bamban Mayor Alice Go's appearance before the Senate yesterday. The PAGCOR's security chief told senators that a former PNP chief aided Alice Go in fleeing the Philippines. Does the PAOC's intelligence match the findings of the PAGCOR's?
Unfortunately, no. We have not heard of the said alleged former PNP chief who has aided Ms. Guo in her escape out of the country. But because of the disclosure yesterday of General Villanueva, we'll have to look into it by now.
Okay, if you're not yet looking into the possible involvement of a former PNP chief, who is the PAOC then looking at or investigating?
Well, we're looking at some private individuals and the mayor of Sual, Pangasinan. Primarily because, as disclosed yesterday during the Senate hearing, there is a municipal wharf in the municipality of Sual, Pangasinan. And we've been looking at that municipal wharf as a possible escape point of the Guo siblings. Bear in mind, Katrina, that during the initial appearance of Sheila Guo at the Senate hearing, the subcommittee on their escape, she stated that she left, they took a van, they rode a van leaving Bamban, and it took almost 5 hours. Not Bamban, but it took her 5 hours from Bulacan to Bamban, then Bamban to whichever point in the north, she said. So it's possible that north point could be Sual, Pangasinan.
All right, before we talk about Sual Mayor Liseldo Calugay, let's first talk about what you mentioned, Sheila Go's first appearance in the Senate. I remember back then, you particularly mentioned that reports that the siblings were last sighted in a resort in the western part of Luzon may have been false. Would it be fair to assume that there were at least deliberate attempts to somehow mislead investigators who are looking into Alice Go's escape from the Philippines?
Well, now that we've heard these doppelgangers, we may have to look at that possible angle again. But again, at this point, there is no definite investigation being done towards a particular location. But we're still fairly confident that they left the country via, a yacht maybe, but then for sure it's a sea vessel.
Mm-hmm. How the Guo siblings left the Philippines is quite certain already, but what remains a mystery still is who actually aided them for them to be able to get past Philippine immigration officials. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. earlier vowed that heads will roll over that incident. My question, aside from the Bureau of Immigration's chief, which other agencies or officials is the PAOC looking at that it will eventually recommend to the president to somehow either fire him or dismiss him or her from office?
Oh, no. Let us put it this way. With regards to the investigation of possible individuals who have colluded in allowing Guo Aping and her siblings to escape, the focus of the investigation has been mostly on the individuals that we will be filing charges against with, also like the Sual mayor and so on and so forth. There is no definite link that would, there's no definite evidence that would point to other individuals who are in the bureaucracy. Most of the investigations we've left to the NBI in relation to that particular question, because our primary focus now is to be able to ensure that we file all the necessary charges against individuals linked to the POGO in Bamban and in Porac, likewise against all local chief executives and or members of the bureaucracy who have helped facilitate not so much her escape, but facilitate the operations of this POGO. Whatever leads we get in relation to her escape, we provide it to our law enforcement counterparts, and they're the ones who follow through the said lead.
Okay, let's then focus on these local government officials that you're looking at. Among them, Sual Mayor Liseldo Calugay. He has denied having a romantic relationship with Alice Go. But based on the PAOC's intelligence, how deep is Mayor Calugay's involvement when it comes to the illegal POGO operations in the Philippines?
Now, for one, we really don't care about the romantic relationship, if any. What we're focusing on is their business relationship that transgress, that goes beyond what is legal. Now, no amount of denial that they have, that most of them have stated yesterday, could point to the fact that they do have a business relationship that may have been used as conduits for money laundering. It's for that reason that we're continuing our investigation with regards to the money laundering aspects of the POGO operations. Bear in mind that yesterday and in previous hearings, the senators were able to disclose to the public, prove to the public that all of the companies associated with the Guo siblings, with the Guo family, were not really earning. Whatever they were earning were insignificant and would not be able to explain the huge amounts of financial transactions passing through their bank accounts. And our belief is that businesses that are associated with Guwaping and Mayor Kalugay that are located in Pangasinan may have been used in the same manner as well.
And speaking of those businesses, what have you found out? Are they earning more than they should or more than what is declared in their statements?
No. Remember, it has been presented already in the Senate and in the lower house that most of the businesses that are owned, managed by the Guo siblings could not possibly explain the amount of the billions of financial transactions.
Winston, let me clarify. Let me clarify my question. I was referring to the businesses of Mayor Kalugay in Suwal, Pangasinan. Have you looked into those already? Is it earning as much as it should based on logic or based on their statements and accounts? Mayor Kalugay's businesses, not the Go siblings.
Yeah. Now, with regards to the businesses of Mayor Kalugay, inasmuch as this has been linked to the businesses of Alice Guo, we're looking at the financial transactions of these particular businesses. And unfortunately, we are not at liberty to disclose most of the specifics in relation to those businesses. Why? We filed 87 charges of money laundering against Alice Guo two weeks, if I'm not mistaken. And that is only the first tranche of money laundering charges we're going to file against her. And if any of her financial transactions goes into the financial accounts of Mayor Kalugay, then those financial accounts of Mayor Kalugay would also be subject to our investigation.
Okay.
And as we're saying, we're also filing additional charges of money laundering against Guwaping. There may be a possibility, I'm not saying it's going to be definite, there may be a possibility that some of the financial accounts of Mayor Kalugay would be charged as well.
Okay, without divulging too much details of your investigation, what businesses does Mayor Kalugay own, at least in Suwal, Pangasinan?
Well, a good number. They've been exposed yesterday. We don't believe in his disclosure that he has already divested, for example, from the Happy Penguin Resort. We don't believe, for example, that he has divested in his aqua farm businesses. We don't believe, for example, that the businesses that were listed as aqua farms and in the names of other individuals were actually owned by those individuals. We believe that a good number of them may actually be owned by the good mayor. So these are all subject of continuing investigation. We're simply guided by evidence. If the evidence points that these are not his and indeed his denials are accurate, then we'll let it go. But we owe it to the public and we owe it to the Filipino people and we owe it to ourselves who have started this investigation to simply follow where the evidence leads us.
Have you looked into the mayor's cell N?
Not yet. When it comes to Sal, and I would imagine other agencies of government would have to look at it now that the mayor has been dragged into this particular investigation.
Right.
By the way, the dragging of the mayor into this investigation is not coincidental. There really are many red flags in as far as their business relationships are concerned.
Mm-hmm. And are there actually POGOs operating in Sual, Pangasinan, or in nearby areas?
There are none. There is no POGO in Sual, Pangasinan that we know of at this point, nor in the past.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, it doesn't mean that there never was. It simply means that we haven't seen evidence either way.
All right. Winston, aside from Sual Mayor Kalugay, who other is the PAOK investigating or looking into the operations or possible involvements of other local chief executives? Which places are we looking at?
At this particular point, I am not at liberty to disclose. We were only able to disclose Mayor Kalugay in as much as has already been exposed in the Senate and in the lower house. So we have no other choice but to confirm that he's subject of an investigation. But the rest of possible government officials who may have helped or who may be operating illegal spam farms, those are continuing subjects of investigation, and we could not disclose them at this point, unfortunately.
Can you at least give us a number, just so our viewers will have an idea on how extensive this investigation is?
We're looking at two local chief executives that may have been involved or actually still are involved in illegal POGO operations in the country.
All linked to Alice Go and the POGO operations in Bamban.
At least one is linked to the POGO operations in Luzon, yes.
Okay, so we're looking at two other mayors. We will have to wait and see if Senate investigations or House investigations will eventually unmask who these two local chief executives are. Winston, let's talk about Wesley Go. The last time we heard from his camp, they were saying that he was willing to go back to the Philippines and surrender himself to authorities. Where exactly is Wesley Go now? And what is the update with regard to his return to the country?
Now, with regards to his surrender fillers, we haven't received any, PAOK I mean, given that the only available warrant against Wesley is a Senate legislative warrant. So whatever fillers he's sending, he may be sending it to the Senate, or his lawyers are talking to the senators or the staff of the senator. But as the commission is concerned, we have not received any. Now, where is Wesley Go? The last report we had about his whereabouts is simply attempted to leave Indonesia for Hong Kong. Now, are we putting... No. What I'm trying to say is we don't put too much emphasis on Wesley Go. As far as we are concerned, he is not a major player in this particular problem. The major players are basically the two females, Guaping, Catherine Cassandra Leong, and of course the Chinese nationals Wang Jiang, Duan Renwu, and Zhang Ji, together with Lin Baoying and Shang Rui Jin. By the way, yesterday, the Department of Justice has already filed the information, the complaint before the Pasig RTC against Alice Guaping and her cohorts. That would include Wang Jiang, Lin Baoying, Shang Rui Jin, and the other Filipinos. Now, we're simply waiting for the raffle. In which particular branch this complaint would fall. And if that happens, I would imagine once the RTC has been identified, the RTC branch has been identified, a warrant of arrest is in the offing for all of these individuals.
Okay, speaking of a warrant of arrest, yesterday, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian showed us a map, a graph of the Baofu incorporators, particularly Ji Yang Huang, Yin Bao Ying, Lin Bao Ying, Zhang Ruin Jin, Zhang Jie, and Yu Zhen Kan. While we're waiting for that warrant of arrest to be issued against them, can we confirm if they are still in the Philippines or if, like the Go siblings earlier, they have already fled the country?
They haven't been in the Philippines for quite a long time. Wang Jiang left the Philippines sometime around late March, late June. Zhang Jie, Warren Wu have left the country. Zhang Jie has not been in the country for more than a year. In fact, even before the actual raids, he has not been in the country anymore. Lin Baoying and Zhang Ruijin, Wang Shenkan, they're not here. They're not here. The first two have been incarcerated in Japan, in Singapore, for the biggest money laundering case in that country. They've since been released. One is in Cambodia, the other is in Japan. Then again, that doesn't mean that you won't be able to go after them. Once the arrest warrants are out, you would coordinate with the International Police National Coordinating Bureau here in the Philippines. That would be the Philippine Center for Transnational Crime, PCTC. And once we do that, we'll request for an international arrest warrant, what is dubbed as a red notice. Wherever they are in the world, where Interpol has a jurisdiction, we could go after them.
Mm-hmm. Winston, with all these information at hand, on hand, are you convinced that Alice Goh is among the big fish, or is she just a puppet of these Chinese individuals who were already able to go into hiding?
She's simply a beneficiary of whatever scams, scam proceeds from all of these activities. She's not, I would say that she is in the middle management. She allowed herself to be used for these criminal activities, but she allowed herself to be knowingly used by these criminal activities. I believe that their family is into these particular illegitimate enterprises. And there are still other individuals who have yet to be unmasked in this particular episode. We do have continuing investigations against these foreign individuals and their local conduits, their local enablers. But until and unless we have enough evidence to charge them in court, we won't disclose them.
Okay. Winston from Bambanterlac, let's now go to POGO operations, to illegal POGO operations in Porac, Pampanga. The last we heard is that officials are looking into reports that there are dead bodies allegedly buried in the compound of Lucky South 99. What is the update on this? What is the latest on this?
Yes. Now, we're talking to, we're reevaluating the statements of our witnesses in as much as their statements are quite dated. What do I mean by dated? They go way back to 2021, 2022, no, as far as their personal knowledge are concerned. So we've looked at the entire compound, the several hectares of the Whirlwind compound, and although they have pointed at four different locations, those four different locations have since changed from their from way back, from let's say 21 or 22, and we're still reevaluating their statements if their statements would hold in the application for a search warrant. Because keep in mind, all of our actions must be rooted on legalities. So we have to make sure that their statements would stand scrutiny when we apply for a search warrant. In any case, there is no sense of urgency as far as the diggings are concerned. Because if indeed there are any bodies in this compound, no one would be able to touch them because we have a full perimeter security guarding this particular compound.
Okay, but have we at least identified who these missing or dead persons are? How many are them in particular?
No, we have not identified who they are and how many in particular. We only identified four possible locations. But as to who they are, no. All that we know is they're allegedly foreign nationals, and they used to work for the POGO in Lucky South 99. So those are the minimal information we've gotten from the Filipino witnesses.
Okay, speaking of Lucky South 99, another key figure in that illegal POGO operation is former presidential spokesperson Harry Roque. The House of Representatives already considers him as a fugitive. What information do you already have in terms of the former spokesperson's whereabouts as of this moment?
Let us put it this way. In as much as the former presidential spokesperson is concerned, all that we're doing in relation to him is conduct case build-up to be able to ensure that if ever we do, file criminal charges against him, that those charges would stick. Remember, we already filed criminal charges against the persons of interest in Lucky South 99, Kathy Leong and 52 others. And at the end of that criminal complaint, we stated John Doe and Jane Doe. Those specifically are allotted for individuals that may still be uncovered in our continuing investigation. And if those continuing investigations point to something strong, in as much as evidence are concerned in relation to former presidential spokesman Harry Roque, then we would include him in the charges. But if our continuing investigation do not result in strong evidence against Mr. Roque, then we won't. All that we have against him at this point are circumstantial. This may be enough to be able to file charges against him in the old mechanism of the DOJ. Remember, DOJ now has a Department Circular 20, wherein only criminal charges would only pass muster in relation to the preliminary investigation if the evidence presented goes beyond probable cause. In the past, they allow probable cause. Now, the evidence barometer, the evidence standard is higher. It goes up to a reasonable certainty of conviction. That's a very high bar, no? So at this point, we have not filed anything against Mr. Roque because we have not yet reached that bar. Mm-hmm. And if we don't reach that bar, then we won't file anything against him. But as far as the 52 others and Kathy Leong are concerned, we've got enough for conviction.
Okay. Winston, I understand that you mentioned that most of the pieces of evidence linking Roque to Lucky South 99 are circumstantial. But you also mentioned in one press conference a few weeks ago that there seems to be too many coincidences for the PAOK and other officials to ignore. What is the missing link here? Why do these evidence still not tag Attorney Roque into the Lucky South 99's operations, considering that, as you mentioned before, there are quite too many coincidences at this point?
Yes. The good number of coincidences basically just transferred him from someone who was not a person of interest to someone who is a person of interest. So all these coincidences, circumstantial evidence, so to speak, point him as having been, associated in one way or the other to Lucky South 99 and some of its activities. But then again, as I've stated, all of those coincidences that now transfer into, that now count as circumstantial evidence, may not be strong enough to pass the current evidence standards set by Department Circular 20 of the Department of Justice. That's why it's a continuing investigation. But again, if we do reach that evidence, that high evidence standard, then we would file charges against him. But then again, if we don't, then we won't.
Mm-hmm. Attorney Roque's refusal to submit several documents to the House Quad Com, as well as his supposed moves to go into hiding. Do you see these as red flags?
No, not necessarily. The documents that the House Quad Com is asking from him is of interest to us, of course. But red flags, not so much, no? Not so much. As I've stated, the fact that he doesn't want to appear before the Congress, before the House of Representatives, that is a matter between him and the House of Representatives. As far as our task group is concerned, we're looking at different angles, different pieces of evidence that may or may not point to his possible involvement in Lucky South 99.
Okay.
So I defer to Mr. Roque. I defer to Attorney Roque if he would subject himself to that investigation again or not.
Okay, Winston.
That is not for PAOK to say.
All right, Winston, another concern that was raised in yesterday's hearing was Senator Gatchalian flagging the possible involvement of banks with regard to illegal offshore gaming firms. Has PAOK already looked into how banks may possibly be involved in the operations of illegal gambling here in the country?
Now, with regards to financial investigations, Katrina, that's within the mandate of the Anti-Money Laundering Council, and they've made a public statement during the filing of the initial set of money laundering charges against Gua Ping and the rest of her cohort that they're indeed looking at, they're conducting an investigation with regards to the banks and other financial institutions through which the financial transactions of Gua Ping and her allies, her associates, have passed through. Now, whether that's finished or not, we have no idea yet. But today, at 10 p.m., actually, we've got a meeting as a task group, and probably one of the reports that will be submitted is this particular issue.
Okay, you have a lot on your plate, Winston, I understand. But based on your hierarchy of priorities, what is your top mission on hand, given everything that's happening both in the House and in the Senate?
Top mission is to be able to fulfill the mandate, the order given by our president last July 22, that all of the concerned agencies in the fight against illegal pogos or scum farms are able to ensure that they're stopped and they end all of their operations by the end of the year. It is a tall order, but then we're doing our best. We're doing our best to be able to fulfill that marching order of the president. But if ever we fall short, we would make it known to the public. But rest assured, whatever happens, all of us in the task group are doing more than what we should, in fact, because some of us are already reporting to the office practically 24/7. I mean, all of the members of the task group, for example, last Sunday, some prosecutors were still working on complaint affidavits up until 11 o'clock in the evening. That was a Sunday, to be able to ensure that we're able to finish all of the criminal charges filings in relation to Bamban. Because as disclosed yesterday, we've given ourselves until the end of October to file all charges in relation to Bamban.
That's a few weeks from now, Winston. I understand that your office is quite undermanned. Did you at least receive an increase in budget for next year?
I hope so. We've seen the support that we've been getting from the Senate and the House of Representatives, and I'm sure they'll follow through. They'll follow through with their pronouncements. But no matter what happens, the commission under our leadership, under Secretary Gilbert Cruz and Executive Secretary Lucas Vibers, we'll make do with what we have.
Winston, I understand that aside from Porac and Bamban, the PAOK is also looking into other areas where illegal POGOs might be operating. What's happening there right now? Are you also close to actually finding out another scheme similar to what you saw in Bamban and in Porac?
We have 6 continuing live investigations as we speak. So whichever comes first in relation to our ability to file for a search warrant will operate against them. Again, these are 6 continuing live investigations.
Any idea? Can we have an idea as to where these 6 live operations are?
All over the country.
What a safe answer. Not even Luzon, Visayas, or Mindanao.
They're all over the country. That's all that I can say.
All right. Last question, Winston. There is a push to actually provide internet gaming licenses in lieu of the crackdown on POGOs. Are you in favor of this move, or do you see this as a sort of a new collar on an old dog?
As far as our operational experience is concerned, we'd rather not have an IGL, internet gaming license or internet gaming operations to take the place of offshore gaming operations. I feel, and this is my professional opinion, I feel that the Philippine gaming regulators, that the investment protection area, the investment areas in the country are still ill-equipped to be able to look at any scamming activities or any illicit activities in this gaming operation. So until and unless we have the proper regulatory mechanism, I would suggest and beg beg from our, I'm begging because of our tired bodies and our tired minds. I'm begging that please, they don't revisit that idea.
Are you looking into possible lobbyists who are pushing for the for this IGL scheme in place of the POGOs?
Of course. Lobbyists are created for a reason, to lobby for their interests. And their interests may not necessarily be good for the national interest. So I do hope that the members of Congress, for example, are not swayed into believing that this particular new dog, old dog with a new collar, will be better than the old collar. It won't. It won't. And from our operational experience.
And are you looking at government officials who are acting as lobbyists for these IGLs?
No. At this point, no. We have no idea. We don't have the time and the resources to look into that particular issue.
That's unfortunate. Finally, Winston, would it be fair to say that the push for the IGL, these internet gaming licenses, is actually a way of skirting President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s directive and mandate to ban all POGOs in the Philippines?
Well, in as much as we don't have evidence either way, I could not definitely give an opinion on that. But as far as we are concerned, we are going to follow the instructions of the President to the letter. And by when he said last July 22 that he's calling on the banning of POGOs, it meant, as far as we are concerned, that from that particular day until the end of the year, there should be no more operations of offshore gaming in the country, wherever they may be located and whatever form or manner they have been raising.
And we will have to leave it at that. I know you're a busy man, so thank you so much for joining us this morning. PAUK spokesperson Winston Casho.
Thank you very much, Katrina. Have a good day.